Hello everyone, I'm Lucy and I'm with Walks 101 and we are out of isolation, a series of videos where we out of work tour guides go around in the city of Melbourne to show you what we love about this city. I'm joined today by my friend John. Say g'day. Hello. John.
How are you going? G'day. Welcome guys, my name is John, I'm a tour guide at Walks 101. Well, I'm not originally from Melbourne, I have lived here for quite a long time, and I am excited to share with you today one of my favorite places. It's just behind me right now. This kind of Greco-Roman looking building is actually our parliament. Beautiful building. Actually, I was very specifically cropping out the part that's beautiful because half of it is under renovation at the moment. So I'm going to walk over this way, away from that, and tell you about this incredible place. This today is the state parliament for Victoria, and it's one of the most beautiful parliaments I've ever been inside. It was built during the gold rush, and it was Melbourne just trying desperately to show off its incredible wealth. And so they built this amazing building to be not the state parliament, but the colonial parliament. This is the colonial parliament for Victoria because up until 1901, all the colonies of Victoria, which is Victoria, New South Wales, Queensland, Tasmania, South Australia, Western Australia, and the different territories like the Northern Territories, they all unified together and became a country. But until then, all the states were pretty distinct. 1901 is relatively recently, and so you have to really remember that with the country only becoming a country so recently, we've got a lot of cultural differences over here. If you're in Victoria, for example, and you go to a bar and you order a beer, you'll order the beer in either a pint or a pot. If you go to New South Wales, they talk about schooners and middies. It's not different words, the same thing. It's entirely different measurements. Here, we like football, and we have a video with Lucy talking just about that. But over there, they like rugby. And so it's a very different thing. So this parliament over here was regulating the colonial parliament all the way until 1901. Which is when federation happens. Federation is the unification of all these different colonies, and when the colonies decided to federate, they had one big pickle of a debate on their hands, which is where should the capital go? Sydney, of course, thought the capital should be over in Sydney, but we here in Melbourne knew that they were completely wrong about this. The capital should be in Melbourne, and we just couldn't come to an agreement about it. And so the result of that agreement was that we made Canberra. Canberra is our Australian capital territory, and it is also a purpose-built city that took 26 years to build. Because it took 26 years to build, we needed a place to govern in the intervening period, and that became that building just behind me. So it's one of my favorite buildings, beautiful architecture over there. Lucy, where are you today?
I'm in front of one of my favorite buildings, actually. This is the Royal Exhibition Building here in the city of Melbourne. When John was talking about the Parliament of Australia coming together in 1901, this is where it happened. This is where they convened the first Australian Parliament back in May of 1901, because it was really the only building in Australia that was big enough for the party. There was about 14,000 people who were invited to the opening of the Australian Parliament, and the exhibition building was the only one big enough for the job. Then the Parliament moved over to the Victorian Parliament House, where John is right now, and the Victorian Parliament moved here.
It's a beautiful building, the Royal Exhibition Building. It's a UNESCO-listed building, and it's pretty darn impressive. But before we get more into that building, I have to talk more about this building that's behind me. I got the beautiful W-class tram, production values, passing behind me there. That's the oldest tram that still runs here in Melbourne. It's also very noisy, so apologies for the audio quality. But the building that's behind me, the Parliament building, is one of the most unique Parliament buildings I've ever seen in my life. Now, you're going to have to imagine a mirror image, because we do have that whole bit under scaffolding right now. But just imagine this side repeated over on that side, and that's our Parliament building. When this building was initially built, the center section didn't exist. Now that's called the Victoria Hall in the center section, but that wasn't there. And so you had this structure on that side with the lower house, the House of Commons, that section on that side with the upper house, the Senate, over there. And in the middle, well, this is Bourke Street. And Bourke Street just kept passing right on through. It was the only example in the world of a bicameral legislature, the legislature with two houses in it, where there's a road crossing between them. You had to exit one building, cross the street, then go up the other. The building was built in pieces because Melbourne was exploding in population. The population of this city went from 75,000 to 500,000 in just 10 short years. And so this building was built piecemeal. It's a beautiful disaster, this building. So it starts out with the two houses, then they build the center hall, but they weren't done yet. They had plans to build a dome. Actually, Lucy, do you have view of the dome behind you right now?
The dome of the Royal Exhibition.
Of the
building.
Royal Exhibition, yeah.
Through the trees, yeah, I do. Oh, look at that. There she is. How beautiful.
So that dome,
you can't see me, but you can see the dome.
Well, that dome's like a classic example of architecture in this era. And this Parliament building was supposed to have a dome just like that. The Victorians got a bit ahead of themselves because there are postcards and commemorative plaques that were put up with the Parliament building, complete with a dome. The thing is, the gold rush ended. 1892 came and the stock market crashed, and as a result they never finished the dome, and so there are these pretend pictures of a building that never was right over here. So it's a pretty incredible building. It's also a building that offers tours, so once this coronavirus crisis has passed, I encourage you to come on back and go on one of the free tours. They operate whenever the Parliament is not in session. They have one that goes every second hour. You'll have to go on their website to find out exactly when. But if you're a nerd like me, every few months they give what's called the architecture tour. And it's basically the tour guide taking you to every nook and cranny of the building that the 45-minute tour doesn't bring you to. So that's the one that I geeked out about. What's your building over there, Lucy? Is it initially purpose-built for the Parliament?
No. So the Royal Exhibition Building, there she is once again behind me. We've got a different angle going on this time. They first started building it in 1879. They finished it in 1880, just in time for the International Exhibition in October of 1880 to be held here in the city of Melbourne. The Royal Exhibitions, there were about 50 of them over the course of the late 1800s, early 1900s. They're essentially just a get-together of people from all over the world to celebrate the achievements of those nations. It was a pretty big deal in 1880 that the exhibition came to the city of Melbourne, because it was the first time that it was held in the Southern Hemisphere. Something that we are very proud of in Melbourne, something that we don't seem to get over, is being able to say, first in the Southern Hemisphere. Very exciting.
Which, of course, we all know here in Australia that that's a ridiculous bragging right, because the vast majority of the world population is in the Northern Hemisphere, but people who come from the Northern Hemisphere don't know that, and so we just say, oh yeah, it's the biggest in the Southern Hemisphere, realizing that it's only a small percentage of the world's population down here. Or am I being too glib?
There's a lot of ocean in the Southern Hemisphere as well, but shh, don't tell anyone.
I'm spoiling all our secrets right now. What is the exhibition building used for today, Lucy?
Well, it's used for several different things. There are still exhibitions of sorts in here. And if you were going to be coming to Melbourne for the trade fair, if you were coming for International Film Festival, if you were coming for Fashion Week, those sorts of things, because it is still a big and beautiful space that gets used quite often for those type of events. As a Melburnian, as someone who has been to university in the city of Melbourne, I actually recognise this building more for the fact that I've had to sit exams here. Because once again, it's one of the few buildings across Melbourne that is large enough to house hundreds and thousands of university students at once. And so this building sometimes gives me the shivers. But in terms of the architecture and the design by Joseph Reed, it's actually quite a stunning building.
I can't think of a better place to have an exam, but at the same time, it's like, yeah, aren't you a bit distracted by all the beautiful architecture around you when you're trying to sit this thing?
You can be, and there are still some beautiful murals on the ceiling as well, so it can be quite distracting. As with most of these 19th century buildings, you always have a little bit of construction going on, whether or not it's renovation or they are just trying to clean up a bit of the dust. There is always noise at the Royal Exhibition Building, some form of beeping or sanding or drilling, so that can also get a little bit distracting when you're trying to remember the different blood groups and antigens on red blood cells.
Well, the last thing I want to do to wrap things up here is that I've now climbed up to the top of the steps of the Parliament building, which too few people do. You come up here and it's only a little bit of height, but the view is incredible. A few things that you can see around us right over here. First off is the beautiful Prince's Theatre, which until last week was housing Harry Potter. It still is housing Harry Potter and the Cursed Child, but it sadly can't go on during the midst of the coronavirus crisis. But also you might be able to see just next to that building, there's that little brick facade right over there. So it's got paint on it, And the name on the paint is the name of the person who made the Prince's Theater. That is one of the great hidden bars of Melbourne. To get to it, you have to walk down Spring Street, look for a very small sign that says Melbourne Supper Club. You want to be dressed up and you want to have money to burn because it's the most expensive cocktail bar in Melbourne. You go up to the top of that thing and it's both a cocktail bar and a cigar bar in the open air. So they have all these beautiful cigars. If you feel like dropping $70 on a cigar and $32 on a cocktail, that is the place to go for it. Finally, the last thing I'd like to point out here is where that tram behind me is turning. That is Bourke Street. You might be able to tell there that it's going downhill. So we are actually gathered right here on one of the two highest points in the city center of Melbourne, Flagstaff Gardens being the highest and this being the other. This would have been an Aboriginal gathering place, which means that this has been a place where decisions have been made, not just for 200 years, but for tens of thousands of years. And for that reason, I do want to take a moment to acknowledge that all of these tours are taking place on Aboriginal land. And so I want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land that these tours are taking place and pay respects to their elders, past, present, and forthcoming. That's about all I have for the Parliament Building. Lucy, what else? Do you have anything else to say about the Exhibition Centre?
Well, I've learned quite a lot from John, actually, today, about the Parliament Building, which is an amazing thing. You know, I've lived in Melbourne almost my entire life. I spent a few years living overseas in Germany, but I've learned a lot about my own Parliament Building that's been on my doorstep for most of my life today through this video, which has been great. But I do want to share something that I think John might not know, and that is a little bit of information about the flags that you see flying from a lot of the buildings that we see throughout the city of Melbourne, which is the Australian flag. And once again, bringing it back to the Exhibition Building, this is where the flag was first unveiled back in 1901. They had a competition in 1901 to design the new Australian flag, and there were tens of thousands of entrants. I think there were about 30,000 entries, and amazingly, the design that was chosen was from about five different entrants, and they all designed something that was remarkably similar to each other. So instead of the £200 prize for the winning design going to one person, five people shared it. One of them was a recognized artist. Two of them were from the city of Melbourne. One of them was only 14 years old. There was another entrant who was 18 years old, and then also a man from New Zealand who entered the competition and was one of the winners. And so five very similar designs from five completely different people from different parts of the country of Australia somehow managed to design a very similar flag. And you can't see it all that well from the building today because of the sunshine, but you know, go on Google, look up the Australian flag, see what it looks like, well, and you can find it there.
What I can do also to end off this video is I can superimpose the flags. I'll put them right over here to this side of me. I'm going to put two flags on the screen. One is the Australian flag, which will be up here on the top, and one is down here going to be the Victorian flag, because one of the biggest confusions people have in this area is, why do you have the same flag twice? Look closely and you'll notice that the flags aren't the same, but they're remarkably similar. So the difference is that the Australian flag has that big Commonwealth star down on below the Union Jack, and that Commonwealth star has a point for each one of the states of Australia and then one for the territories as well. The Victorian flag, being a colony flag and later a state flag, didn't need the Commonwealth star because it wasn't about the other states or colonies. And also because it was Victoria, named after the Queen, we had to put the crown right on the top. Just to remind everyone that we're named after the Queen, because when Victoria was created, Queen Victoria was our Queen. So that's about all that we have for you today, guys. Thank you so much for joining in. This has been Out of Isolation. It's a daily web series created by the guides here at Walks 101 who are suddenly find themselves out of work. And so we are now giving you our tours digitally. If you would like to support this show, just click the subscribe button below. That gives us a whole lot more features. If you're feeling incredibly generous, you're also welcome to go to our Patreon page. So I'll put the link in the description over here. And you can actually donate. You can donate to help us do this thing every single day. All the money is going to be given out to our guide team, who's participating in the videos. So thank you all for joining in. Goodbye from me. And Lucy, I'll let you take us out.
Thank you very much for joining us, everyone. Have a great day and stay safe. Wash your hands.
Bye.
Bye.
Cool. I think that went well. I think that went actually smoother than the first one.
Yeah, pretty much.
Do you know what I mean? Like, it's like, once you get going, it's like, oh, we've got enough on here. We can, yeah. we could probably bang out 10 more if we wanted to right now, you know?
Yeah. I'm trying to think of what else.